The Legends of the West, Deadwood, South Dakota. Written by Charles River Editors. Narrated by David Zarbock. Introduction. On Wednesday, about 3 o'clock, the report stated that J.B. Hickok, Wild Bill, was killed. On repairing to the hall of Nuttall and Mann, it was ascertained that the report was too true. The Black Hills Pioneer. Space may be the final frontier, but no frontier has ever captured the American imagination like the Wild West, which still invokes the images of dusty cowboys, outlaws, gunfights, gamblers, and barroom brawls over 100 years after the West was settled. A constant fixture in American pop culture, the 19th century American West continues to be vividly and colorfully portrayed not just as a place, but as a state of mind. In Charles River Editor's Legends of the West series, readers can get caught up to speed on the lives of America's most famous frontier figures in the time it takes to finish a commute, while learning interesting facts long forgotten or never known. The Wild West has made legends out of many men, but it also forged a lasting legacy for a few of the West's most legendary towns. And alongside the city of Tombstone, Arizona, perhaps the most famous of them was Deadwood in the Black Hills of South Dakota. Deadwood owes its notoriety to some of the colorful people who called it home, and a recent critically acclaimed television series about the town that brought it to life for millions of modern viewers. In many ways, Deadwood fit all the stereotypes associated with the Old West, a mining town that sprung up quickly. It was a dusty place on the outskirts of civilization that brought together miners, cowboys, lawmen, saloons, gambling, brothels, and everything in between, creating an environment that was always colorful and occasionally fatal. In fact, Deadwood should have never legally existed. In 1874, General George Armstrong Custer led a troop of over 1,000 men to investigate reports of the discovery of gold on Lakota Sioux land in the Black Hills. Sioux ownership of the land stemmed from the Treaty of Laramie in 1868, but the discovery of gold changed things for the United States. The mining town of Deadwood quickly sprung up as prospectors descended on the area. Even though the federal government had ordered military troops to set up posts there to keep prospectors out, these characteristics might not have distinguished Deadwood from other frontier outposts that dotted the landscape. But some of the West's most famous legends of the West called Deadwood home. Men like Al Swearengen and Charlie Utter came to make fortunes one way or another. Calamity Jane amused and irritated the townspeople in equal measure. And the legendary Wild Bill Hickok was shot and killed in one of Deadwood's saloons while holding the dead man's hand by the coward McCall. Wild Bill's death helped ensure Deadwood would be remembered as an important part of Western lore. But in many ways, the Deadwood craze was over almost before it began. During the 19th century, Deadwood's population reached its peak in the 1880s, with a population of just less than 4,000. And fires, mining, and the closing of the frontier all made sure the population grew. Today, barely 1,000 call Deadwood home, and it remains more of an object of curiosity and tourism than anything else. Legends of the West, Deadwood, South Dakota, comprehensively covers the history of the city, profiles the people who called it home, and highlights the attractions and events that made it famous. You will learn about Deadwood like you never have before, in no time at all. Chapter 1. The Birth of Deadwood. Before Deadwood became an iconic town of the western frontier, the area surrounding the Black Hills of southwestern South Dakota and eastern Wyoming was the land of the Lakota Sioux. The Lakota had claimed the land after they defeated the Cheyenne in 1776. And they called the mountains Pahasapa, or Black Hills, because the forest was so densely populated with trees that from a distance, the land appeared to be black. The Black Hills were so important to the Lakota that they considered it holy land and even incorporated it into their creation story. According to their legends, the first human reached the surface of the earth through a cave traditionally believed to be Wind Cave in the Black Hills. In 1868, the United States government and the Lakota Sioux signed the Treaty of Laramie, which brought an end to Red Cloud's war in north-central Wyoming and removed the rival Ponca Indians from Lakota territory. The treaty stipulated that the Black Hills were to belong to the Lakota Sioux forever, for the absolute and undisturbed use and occupancy of the Sioux. Whites could not enter the territory without the express permission of the Lakota, which was essential because the Black Hills were considered sacred to the natives. In addition, the Treaty of Fort Laramie dictated that the U.S. Army would abandon forts along the region. It took less than a decade for things to change as a result of the discovery of gold. The first rumors of gold in the region began to surface in 1834, long before the Laramie Treaty was signed. A Jesuit missionary said he saw gold in the mountains, but when prospectors rushed in, the natives attacked them. Another group of white miners was chased out of the region in 1852. The Lakota Sioux knew there was gold on their land, but they didn't fully understand the value it held in white society. Without promise of government help, private citizens took matters upon themselves. Charles Collins, an Irishman from Sioux City, Iowa, led the campaign to open up the Black Hills to prospectors. Collins was an abolitionist who claimed to have been run out of Missouri for his anti-slavery views. He was also a newspaper man who saw an opportunity for Sioux City to flourish as miners passed through town on their way to the Dakota Territory. Energetic and known as something of a jokester, Collins' own path through the U.S. can be traced through the directories he published. These publications show Collins making his way through Colorado, Nevada, Kansas, and then Omaha, Nebraska. By 1870, Collins had made his way across the Missouri River from Omaha to Sioux City. The town's riverfront location and the fact that three railroads passed through helped Sioux City grow to a population of 6,000 by the time Collins had arrived. Meat and wheat were exported from Sioux City, and it was an important wholesale and retail center, not to mention a center of Native American trade. The U.S. government contracted with Sioux City businessmen to provide the Sioux in the region with corn and pork, which was shipped up the Missouri River on steamboats to Indian agencies. With the foundation already in place for Sioux City, Collins believed that opening up the Black Hills for mining would bring untold riches to the community, as well as force the Sioux to move out. He organized the Black Hills Mining and Exploring Association of Sioux City on February 27, 1872. With Collins as president of the organization and Sioux City Journal editor Dan Scott acting as vice president, they launched an aggressive promotional campaign in the city newspapers. Thomas H. Russell, a prospector hired by the organization to develop an expedition, traveled up and down the Missouri River to speak to the townspeople and to lecture about the opportunity just waiting for them all in the Black Hills. Soon, it seemed that all anyone wanted to talk about was gold mining. White prospectors did not wait for the government to act and began to invade the Black Hills, despite warnings from the government that doing so could start a war with the Lakota Sioux.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.